TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest. And tonight I have two wonderful groups coming in. One is a little younger than normal, but they're such a fine group of people led by a very experienced director. So we're going to have a lot of fun finding out about what their production is later on. But before we start, I just want to mention that up there at Muhlenberg College, they're doing Gertrude Stein's Challenging Listen to Me. It opens February the 22nd and runs through the 26th at Muhlenberg College stage. And you can go on their website for information about that. It looks like it's going to be a very interesting, challenging production piece. And if you're interested in Gertrude Stein and her work and all the women's movement and all, I think you'll be wanting to get up and see that. Kudos to them for doing this production. And we wish them well. Break a leg, folks. And now for another college, we have our favorite local college, Albright College, with us tonight. Tonight we have the Domino Players and their production of Intimate Apparel, and we're going to find out a little bit about that show. With me tonight is Jula Matthews, and next to her is Brianna Brownley and Jennifer Raineri. Welcome all to Backstage.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Now, these are some of the folks that are putting this together, and we'll find out a little bit about it. Jula, welcome again to Backstage, and tell us where and when Intimate Apparel is going to be done.
Right. So we're excited to be here. We're just about to start our dress rehearsals because the show opens next Thursday. That's Thursday, February 23rd, and we have performances on the 23rd, 24th, and 25th at 8 p.m., and Sunday, February 26th at 2:30, and that's all in the Wachovia Theater at Albright College's Center for the Arts.
Okay. And how can they get tickets for this?
Well, you can go to our website, www.albrightcollege.edu, and look for the Center for the Arts link. You can buy tickets online. There's also our box office phone number is... is 610-921-7547, and be glad to reserve tickets for you that way as well.
Very good. And I want to thank Marissa, who's at the box office. She was very helpful with some of the production promotions this month, and also thanks for the help with that. She'll be happy to help you out with tickets for this show. Let's get find out about the show. Give us a synopsis of it, please.
Okay. Well, this is a play by Lynn Nottage, who's one of our great American playwrights, woman who's now, I guess, close to 50. And this is a play that she wrote in 2003. But the play is set in 1905, New York. And it's very much about that period of 1905 when there's um, tremendous growth in the big urban cities in the United States, and there's great migration, people coming up from the South, like Brianna's character as part Esther, who comes up to New York as part of the Great Migration, but also immigrants coming from the Caribbean, from Europe, lots and lots of population explosion of new New Yorkers and new Americans coming into New York City. So that's sort of the moment of the play. But so although it takes place in a very crowded city at a time of huge growth and change, the play takes place in bedrooms, in private rooms, as the title maybe would suggest. Brianna's character is Esther Mills, who is a seamstress who makes beautiful lingerie and corsets and intimate apparel for ladies. And because she does that kind of work, and she's very skillful and at it and a real artist in her own way, because she does that, she has access to people in their private bedrooms. And the play follows her to several different bedrooms through the course of the play. We see her in her own bedroom, where she's wishing that there would be more in her life besides her work, although she's a very fine craftsperson. We see her go visit one client who's a wealthy society lady, a white lady up on Fifth Avenue, and then we see her also visiting a saloon singer and sometime prostitute down in the Tenderloin District, who's another client and also friend of Esther's. So we sort of see there's a kind of beautiful connection about the way these different women's lives, who are so different in terms of race and class, but when you're down to their undergarments and to their fears and to their hopes and their disappointments, there are many, many points of continuity that Esther sort of hears and listens and is kind of sorting through for herself. And the play actually follows kind of a pen pal. Esther gets a letter from a man who's sort of a acquaintance of her church deacon's son, who's out digging the Panama Canal. And this man is writing letters to this lady he's never met in New York. And they begin a correspondence. And in the first act, we sort of hear them getting to know each other a little bit through their letters. And then in the second act, he arrives. And the rest of Act Two is sort of about how that then changes Esther's life and how the intimate arrangement of her own life begins to change, and the pressures that it puts on her work and her friendships. So I guess that's a synopsis.
Oh, that's set up beautifully. Brianna, tell us a little bit about your character, please.
Well, like Julia said, she's a 35-year-old seamstress. She's a very lady of her time, if you know what I'm saying. Like, she's very proper, put together, and she's very hardworking and independent. But even though she's very, like, independent, she really longs to be with someone, to say the least. But yeah, she just definitely takes pride in her work, and she's very caring and generous.
It's kind of a great story. We hear she talks about coming up from North Carolina after her parents die, coming by herself as a 17-year-old, coming north and making her way to New York City, and then arriving in the city knowing nobody, having nothing, and beginning this business that somebody teaches her how to sew. And she says that's been her livelihood all these years. So she's really, it's really kind of an American success story in a way, this woman coming from nothing and making a business and making a life, and yet she's still then at 35, she has a business, but she doesn't have a family, and she's looking for love.
In many ways, she's quietly liberated and making her own way into society and the norms at that time.
Well, I think that's so interesting about Lynn Nottage and about this play, but all of her plays. I mean, the way she respects women's lives and the kind of work that lots of people do behind the scenes, you know, the kind of unsung heroes, the people who are working hard to make life livable, people who are in service of different kinds, people who are caretakers of different kinds, people who are independent small business people of different kinds. It's so interesting the way she includes women in that story, historically mm-hmm. speaking, that I think we hear less about those independent women small business people than maybe we do, but they're certainly part of that American story of finding independence and making a new place in the country. So,
and that was kind of nice. The unsung hero, we have with us one of the unsung heroes of the of the production staff. Jennifer, tell us a little bit about your contributions to the production.
Well, we started building the costumes early January, and since then I've been putting in countless hours into our costume shop, making the 6 corsets that are worn by the various women in the show, plus everything else that is worn on stage. Mm-hmm. It's very intricate, it's very beautiful, and so it was so exciting to get to work on this show, to get that experience, to work on like this period. It's such a beautiful shape, and there's so much history that goes into these costumes, and they truly reflect the characters. It's really something that I feel like people take for granted. It's really beautiful, like how Julia was saying, how these characters are different, but not so much when you get mm-hmm. to the true center of themselves. It's like what one person wants, it's what the other person has, what the other person has, what the other wants. It's just, mm-hmm. it's really just a great time.
We should give a shout out to Paula Trimpe. Paula Trimpe, who's our designer for this show. She designed the costumes as well as the scenery. She's one of my colleagues on the faculty at Albright. And Paula and Jennifer and how many more people are working in the costume shop? Probably 6 or 7?
Or more.
are working hard, have been working hard for a good long time. Yeah. And I think partly what Jennifer's telling us about is that how interesting the sort of historical construction, that it's not just making it look pretty for the back row of the theater, mm-hmm. but there's a lot of serious scholarship going into the way the garments were built and the way they were decorated and how they fit and how that contributes to our students just are doing so much really interesting work, kind of bridging history with craftsmanship, with fashion, and it's neat the way we get to see these things coming together.
Mm-hmm. Now, both of you are seniors, and mm-hmm. Have you been working in costumes and as an actress throughout your stay at Albright, or have you done other things? A little bit about you. What have you folks done with theater at Albright?
Personally, I came in as a fashion major, mm-hmm. and I just had an interest in theater, and I realized that costuming is essentially the best of both worlds, and I really felt at home in the theater, and I knew that this was like a career I wanted to pursue. And so I continued, and throughout my education, I got to try all different aspects like lighting, stage managing. Soon I'm going to be working on props, so it's really fun to get a wide variety of like hands-on experience with everything.
I'm sure you can appreciate everything that goes on in a production that way by learning a little bit of all the aspects of it. How about you, Brianna?
Well, I started very far from theater as just a psychology major. But eventually I really knew that I wanted to like pursue a career in acting, so I came to theater, and then I ended up learning about like a lot of the history and all the other jobs. So like Jen, like we have to do production experiences, so we all have like different things that we do throughout the theater. But this is my first time actually getting to perform, so it's been interesting.
I'm sure.
So Brianna's completing a dual degree. Oh. Her degree will be both in psychology and in theater when she finishes this spring. So she's got a lot of balls she's keeping juggling in the air.
And they both will serve you very well. OK, Okay. Now let's talk a little bit about the intimate apparel, the costumes for this. Jennifer, you brought a corset in with
yes,
you?
Yes, I have.
hold it up in so that people at home can kind of get an
Let's
idea
see.
About, first of all, what it looks like. Okay, that's just the large.
If we hold it for you, do you want to sort of talk about the different parts of the corset?
Yeah.
Sure. There's many different pattern pieces that go into this. It's made out of coutil fabric, which is very sturdy and resists stretching. There's bones. They used to be made out of whale bones, but now it's flexible metal. This side piece is the busk. Here we have the grommets, which you lace through. And this is the other side of the busk. And the laces go in the back, busk in the front. For this particular corset, we put in bust petals to give it a more rounded shape around the bust. And
so would you like to see it on?
I was just going to get to that. Mm-hmm. Now, if you'll take off your lavaliers and the omnidirectional mic can pick up anything you'd like to mention about putting that on and all. So why don't you get up in front here and show the folks at home how a corset is put on and all that. And this is just part of so many things that go into a costume. To do a production accurately, and to get the actors to move correctly, you do need to get correct costume and costume pieces. So tell us a little bit about this as you're going through this.
Well, I'm trying to loosen up the laces in the back right now so that she is able to close the busk in the front.
Yeah. Could you possibly turn to the side so they can see at home a little bit about what you're doing or...
keep turning just a little bit more.
Yeah, just a little bit more. Maybe
there we go,
camera
so they can see the back.
One or whatever can
right,
catch
right.
that. Oh, good, good. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, as you can see, all those that's laced up. Now, basically, when they put on a corset, wasn't it that they had the front completely put together and then they laced everything together? Or are there different ways of constructing a corset?
And yes, there's different styles depending on the time period. That the one you were referring to is more Renaissance period.
Okay.
This is from like a period of time where people could actually dress themselves.
Mm.
So there was an opening in the front.
Oh, okay. I guess maybe by that time they didn't have the extra help that they had maybe in the courts of the Renaissance era.
Or you think of Scarlett O'Hara hanging onto the bedpost.
Yes.
Well, so how does it, Brianna, I don't know if you can tell us, how does it feel when she's tugging on those strings?
Restricting. Very structured, very different from what we have today.
Mm-hmm.
It definitely changes the way you have to like breathe and like stand. Yeah.
Now, how might that affect you as a character then in your walk or in your speech or whatever? Does that have any effect on that?
Yes, definitely. Basically, everything is very vertical. Like in today's time, we're used to like bending like at the waist and moving around like this, but it really makes you more stationary, like if you have to reach to get something on the floor, it's this instead of this, so it's difficult to move. And as far as speaking, it's more of a challenge to sustain breath and like project your voice because it really restricts your ribcage from expanding. So that's also a challenge, but otherwise, it's fine.
So have you been working with this on stage yet, or will that be coming up and all so that you can become more accustomed to this?
We've worked with it a few times, but I definitely feel like I could use more work, you know, projecting and having to do various things.
Go ahead, pick that up.
But yeah, I definitely could use more work, like going throughout the scenes, wearing it, but we've done it a couple of times.
And one of Brianna's challenges is not only does she have to wear the corsets, but she has to put the other characters into their corsets. So essentially she has to do what Jen was just doing and help the other ladies lace up and fit, and because she's there fitting them into their garments. And there's lots of business, so not only does she have to keep playing the character, but she has to do this work. They are beautiful, the corsets. I mean, they are certainly rigid, and I wouldn't want to be wearing one every day. But there's essence. I mean, do you sort of get to? Are you starting to like them?
It's fun to like experiment with them, but I definitely wouldn't want to wear them every day either, because it does get tiring, like towards the end of the night when you've been wearing it for like an hour. So.
And they wore them what all day? Yeah. I guess. What is it like for the two of you? You as an actress helping the other characters, and you as a costumer. What is it like putting on this corset for each one? How does it work? Is it easy? Are there any problems putting that on or what?
Yeah, it's very difficult because there's a method to put it on. Like, you have to do the busk first, and you have to start from top to bottom and make sure that they tend to like undo themselves, like if you don't hold the top tightly. So that can be a struggle, and having to make sure that like they all stay in line so you could get to the back eventually, and then pull that and make sure all the laces in the back are like correct and like clean looking. So it's difficult.
What do you think about when you're fitting the costumes on the actors? What are you looking for to make sure they look good before they go on stage?
We're looking at like this bust line to make sure it's placed nicely, that all the trims and lace is like positioned in a way that's aesthetically pleasing. For this show, we wanted to get more of like a silhouette as opposed to like a waist trainer. So it does give her the desired S shape that they wanted in the time period, but we didn't make it too restricting so she could deliver her lines and do what she needed to do.
Okay. If you'd like to take that off or leave it on and just come back and put your lavaliers back on, we'll continue seated. It might be a little bit more comfortable. I'm not sure. Since I haven't worn one, at least lately. So why did you, Julia, why did you decide to do this particular production?
Well, you know, I'm really interested in playwrights and in writers and hearing different writers' voices. And Lynn Nottage is such a great American voice. We've been wanting to program one of her plays for years now, and have been thought many times about intimate apparel, partly because my colleague Paula Trimpe is an expert in this period of costume history. And as you know, Lynn Nottage has all these Reading connections with the production of Ruined that the Theater Alliance did a few years ago. Mm-hmm. She was here for that, and then
I remember that.
Done a lot of interviews and documentary theater work, building her most recent play, Sweat, which is going to open on Broadway this spring after having had a successful run in Washington, Ashland, Oregon, and then at the Public Theater in New York City, and now it's going to move to Broadway, and One Night Only was here in Reading for us to enjoy it.
Yes.
So I'm just very interested in Lynn Nottage as a writer who, I think she's inspiring on so many levels, that she's inspiring about her vision of equality, and equality beyond gender or beyond race or beyond sexuality or ethnicity, that her vision of community is very inclusive, and it's an honor to work on her scripts, but also that it gives great roles for some of our African-American actors who are often cast in, say,
non-traditional ways or cast against type. It's really great to hear these talented, talented folks doing material that speaks so much to their stories and their culture, their family ties. That's a really wonderful thing about this play.
Many things were talked about with and themes with this that Dee, you and I briefly went over. But how about talking a little bit about courage to make the move, the fears that are inherent in making any kind of a change, and the migration, whether it would have been from the European side, the African continent, or even just from southern part of the United States at that time, all the way up. Any thoughts on that?
Well, Esther is such an interesting character because although she's, in a way, she's nobody. You know, she's in the background. She's making people's underwear. But in the course of the play, we see her making a lot of scary, bold, risky choices for herself and really taking responsibility for them and deciding when she's made a mistake or when she's going to go ahead and make a mistake anyway and live with the consequences. It's interesting, don't you think? She has a lot of courage.
Yeah.
For somebody who's would seem to be just living quietly, she's making big changes in her life. And
And as a costumer, how does that affect you in the conversation between the director, perhaps the actor, the various designers, set, lighting, etc.? How does that affect you, about the themes and issues in a given show, in making the costume?
That's, I guess, technically more the designer's job, which would be Paula Trimpe. It is reflected in like the wardrobe of the character. You can kind of like see how Esther progresses. Like, she's like often thought of as like plain, and then it may like change throughout for whatever situation that it might call for.
Because I'm sure you're going to be work along with design in some fashion, whether it be everyday clothes, so to speak, or maybe costumes for a theater. So I was just curious as to how that might color your growth and your outlook or your look on costuming and fashion.
It's really nice to have all these different smart people at the table, to have costumers and our student stage managers and prop people and assistant directors and the actors, just a lot of smart people sitting together thinking about the script and offering their points of view. It's really such a fun way to learn, to have so many people engaging in the same effort together and sharing ideas, and we all learn from each other and take new ideas and go back and refine them. So it's fun conversation.
Yeah. And with Wayne Vettelson, there's a shout out to him, who's the lighting director
and designing that
affects everything, whether it be the set design and the colors used. And the set, the costumes, and everything else on that. So it's all wonderful collaboration.
Well, that's the fun of it. That's the fun part of theater, is getting to work with other people.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're down at the end of this segment, and I want to thank all of you for being on the program today. Break a leg with your production. You're welcome. And one more time before we leave this segment, tell us where and when Intimate Apparel is going to be done.
Okay, so this is Intimate Apparel by Lynn Nottage at the Albright College Wachovia Theater on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, February 23rd, 24th, 25th at 8 o'clock in the evening, and then on Sunday, February 26th at 2:30 in the afternoon. And you can get tickets online at www.albright.edu/centerforthearts or by calling our box office at 610-921-7547. We'd love to see you at the show.
Okay, and just a quick note, there's going to be a panel discussion with the National Organization for Women on Monday the 27th, and I believe they'll be bringing up part of this in their conversation as well.
Right, it's going to be a conversation sort of for the community to think about some of the ideas mm-hmm. that are raised in the play and maybe what's mm-hmm. what's the same and what's changed since 1905 and the world of the play. Mm-hmm. Should be interesting.
Yes, break a leg with it.
Thank you, David.
You're welcome. And you folks, I hope you get out to see it. We're going to take a break for production promotions and bring on the next group that are going to be doing a production very soon. For Backstage, I'm your host, David Edgar Guest. You're watching us on BCTV. And welcome back to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and we had some fun with Albright College and the Domino Players and their upcoming production of Intimate Apparel. And now we're going to go to one of our local high school groups. We have a wonderful group of high schools in this area that do very fine work with musicals and comedies and all that throughout the year. And one of them, the musical that is coming up is Xanadu, and that's going to be with Berks Catholic High School, and we're going to find out a little bit about that right now. With me on the program tonight is Debbi Silas. Next to her is Megan O'Neill, Ben Wild, Katie Frederick, and Kaylin Wittmeyer. Welcome all to Backstage.
Thank you, Dave, for having us.
You're welcome. Now, Debbi, you've been on the program many times, and I appreciate you coming back and telling, because you're doing so much in the theater community, both with community theaters and high school. Now, you're working with Berks Catholic right now, and tell us a little bit about Xanadu. Give us a synopsis, please, and where and when it's all going right. to be done.
Xanadu will be opening March 17th at the Berks Catholic High School Auditorium. It runs the 17th and the 18th at 7 o'clock. Tickets are $11 for adults and $9 for students. Mm-hmm. And you can get tickets at www.berkscatholic.org, or you can get tickets at the door. Xanadu is a musical that was created by a local person. It was written by Douglas Carter Bean, who is originally from Wyomissing. And it's kind of a parody and a farce of the musical movie, Xanadu, that was a movie that was made to star Olivia Newton-John back in the 80s. So basically, it's just a lot of fun, a lot of 80s pop rock music, and we're just having a ball.
I can well imagine with that. Let's find out a little bit about the talent that's on the program tonight. We'll start with Megan. Tell us about your role, and have you done any other shows in school or whatever?
Yes. I play Kira/Clio in the show, and she is a Greek goddess who comes down to Earth to save a mortal from destruction and to inspire him so that he can create great art. She's a really fun character. She's really lovable. She's really easygoing and really happy. It's really fun to play her. I've done my school shows for the past 3 years, and I've done a lot of theater outside of school as well.
Good. Okay, Ben Wild, tell us a little bit about your character in the show, and have you done any shows outside of high school or whatever?
My character's name is Sonny Malone. He's the artist that is being inspired by Kira, and he's a very... trying to think of how to put this. He's a very laid back, very very kind of chill guy. He's not always the most intelligent, but he's lovable, and he makes people laugh, which is good. And theater-wise, this is my second show at Berks Catholic. I was in our production of Annie last year, and I've done a show outside of school with Debbi. But other than that, that's all.
Good. Good. All right. Katie Frederick, tell us a little bit about your character and if you've done any shows outside of school.
My character in Xanadu is Melpomene, and she is the oldest of the sister muses. And she is very... mean.
She's, she you say that with such a smile.
Yeah. She's a little goofy,
And gets very jealous. She, like I said, she's the oldest, and Kira is the youngest, and Kira's getting all this attention. She's getting all these gifts. She's, you know, hanging out with this mortal dude. He's really cool, and I just can't take it. And I just really can't handle it, so I get very angry, and the whole show, I'm just sort of trying to sabotage, like, Kira's happiness. As far as theater goes, I've done the shows since freshman year. I'm a junior now, and outside of this, I've only done one musical with my eighth grade class in grade school, so.
Good. Okay, and Kaylin Wittmeyer, tell us a little bit about your role.
Well, I play Calliope. She's another one of the sister muses, and I, along with Melpomene, Katie, we kind of plot the downfall of Kira, you know, we try to. it's interesting because, you know, we get to play the antagonist in the show, but it's also a really fun role, you know, even though we're evil, we're kind of comically evil. So it's a really interesting role to play. And as for theater, I've done all the shows at Berks Catholic. I'm a senior with Meg and Ben. And I've done a couple shows outside with Mrs. Silas and a couple other companies. And I've been acting for film and television for 10 years. So,
Very good. Okay. Now, we have this muse. Tell us a little bit about the muse and what is it to the show and what is it to people in general. Let's find out a little bit about that. What are your thoughts on Kira, the muse?
I think that the point of the muses is we all have this special area in which we specialize. I'm the muse of history, and I'm the leader of the muses. So history is the place where I specialize. But the point behind the entire muse thing is that in order for mortals to create art or to create writing or to be inspired in any way, they need someone to be that first mover to give them that little shove. So I think the whole idea behind the muses is that these are the people that come into our lives even briefly and inspire us in some small way, even though they might never come back or they might disappear immediately. But they're the little people in our life that just kind of give us the ideas for everything that we do.
I think, like, what Meg said, it's, you know, as the muses, we get to play people that are inspiring humans. And I think, you know, as actors, even just in high school, that's something we can really connect with because, you know, any type of performing, any type of art is really special. And so getting to play what people believed inspired people to create art is really interesting and really fun to do.
As a director, tell us your thoughts on the muse in this. I know this is a lot of fun and all this, you know, but you have to have some kind of background.
Yeah. Sunny, at the beginning of the show, is kind of lost. Mm-hmm. He is a street artist. He is working on a chalk drawing on a wall. Doesn't feel like he's got anywhere to go. Kira comes out of the blue, as Megan said, to inspire him. And what he wants to do is he wants to build a place that art and music and even athletics can all come together in one space. So he comes up with, I want to build a roller disco. So we are roller skating in the show, okay? it is so much fun to watch these students of the 2017 getting involved in the music and the craziness that we lived through in the 80s, and just to be inspired by some of the things that happened back then. So I think inspiration is kind of like the ultimate word for the production, and also that because these two fall in love, and that's against the rules as far as the gods go, So then that's complications that lead into things later on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have a lot to of actually background in there, because you have muses, you've got the gods, the mythology.
Yep, we have of the Greek gods
there. And all the ancients. How does that all tie together and all? And learning about that and bring these people, these characters to life.
Well, we actually had to have one of the teachers actually looked up all the names of the Greek, of the muses, because we could not pronounce them.
Oh, yeah.
And, we had to go through this, like, little training session. I still don't always say them right, so I kind of shorten them. Mel and Cal, that kind of thing, so.
Calliope, I got
Melpomene.
And nobody gets it right.
No,
it's okay. Melpomene?
Call me Melpomene.
Melpomene.
Yes.
I was thinking of something else on that, and all Melpomene.
But each of the muses, there's nine of them all together, and they each have their own special interest or
speciality. Their specialty in the muse of art or the muse of history or whatever. Very fascinating aspects of life in the past, and we actually have our own muses now. We just don't call them that,
right.
And all that. Now, we have a little sampling for you from the show, and I'm going to ask Debbi to set it up. And Katie and Kaylin, if you'll take off your lavaliers and come out to the front here.
Mel and Cal, are kind of the evil sisters that do not want Kira to succeed in the things that are going on. So the song that they're going to be singing is a song which I'm sure many people are familiar with. It's Evil Woman, and they are singing about themselves and how they react to Kira.
Come out here in the center stage and take it. And we'll get the music right up there.
You girls ready?
All ready.
Yes.
Okay, I hope this is the right place. Wait. Hang on a minute.
Yeah, the fun thing with doing a live program is, this is it.
Okay. You ready?
Go ahead.
How you broke me up. You made the wine, now you drink the cup.
All right. Very well. Good. Very good. Thank you. Yeah. Give him a hand. All right. From Xanadu, Evil Woman. Now, there's so many different songs. Tell us a little bit about the songs that are a blast from the past for those of us or new to the younger generation.
Of course, Xanadu is
oh, yes.
Suddenly.
We Do Fool by Olivia Newton-John.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And You Have to Believe We Are Magic.
Mm-hmm.
Have You Ever Been Mellow? So it's mm-hmm. just full of a lot of really fun, upbeat kind of music.
All right. It sounds like so much fun. There's so much going on in there.
And Dave, it's the first time it's been done in Berks County.
It is? Oh, yes. Well.
Never been done.
Yes. Wonderful. Yes.
Any schools or any community theater groups mm-hmm. in Berks County.
Especially in recent history, anyway. I don't know what it is. But yeah, that's fun. How much have you guys gotten out of this from learning about some of the music from the past? Have you found things to enjoy it?
We had so much.
Tell us.
It's so much fun. I mean, we're all learning how to roller skate. It's like a skill I never thought I would have.
She's on skates
right now. Yeah.
The entire show.
Okay. All right.
So she's on them now, so mm-hmm. she's in character. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. I am glad it's you and not me. I have learned as a youth that my two legs can go in so many different directions at one time on roller skates. Forget it. So, congrats.
Thank you. I also think we're gaining a certain level of respect from music from the 80s because we always kind of enjoyed it, but we never really were immersed in it. And now our entire life is in this like little 80s bubble.
Well, it's a lot of fun, and it broadens the appreciation you have for many different forms and styles. I know that. We're coming close to the end, and I want to find out from each of you, do you have a muse or muses that you look up to or give you inspiration for this show or anything else? Mm-hmm. How about anyone can start.
Oh.
What a great question.
Never really thought about
that.
Mm-hmm.
I think depending on what the situation is or mm-hmm. what show it is, I personally draw experience from different areas of my life and different people.
Mm-hmm.
For this show specifically, my muse, my inspiration is Olivia Newton-John because I'm Olivia Newton-John in this show.
Okay.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'd have to say for me, for this show especially, I'd have to say my mom because she loves the 80s, you know, mm-hmm. that's her music. And so as soon as I said we were doing Xanadu, you know, when we first got the announcement at the end of last year, she started singing the song right away. So it's been really fun even just to learn the music like with her, you know, and seeing how much people enjoy the music is really making it a fun show to do.
Mm-hmm.
I have some absolutely wonderful friends in my life that are nearly family to me, that inspire me in absolutely everything that I do, but especially in the show because they're in the cast as well. So I get to work with them and we get to see them all the time and they inspire me to do well and to impress them and all that. But yeah, so I'd definitely say them and of course my family. So
great.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, I think for me, somewhere along the lines of what Kaylin said, for this is my mom, because she grew up in the 80s, and so when she found out we were doing Xanadu, she's like, wait, that's Olivia Newton-John, and she starts like humming the song, and then just throughout the day, things I'll notice that like give me ideas that I never had before, like reading through the script and seeing words that I don't recognize, and hearing my mom use like 80s slang in conversation, I know what that means now. So yeah, I'd say it's my mom for this. But.
And you, Debbi, have you had a muse?
I don't know. I don't. I don't know. I'm at a loss for words.
I would say you've been amused to many students throughout the years.
Oh, for sure.
And all.
Definitely. Yes.
Well, we're out of time, and all quickly before we sign off, tell us where and when Xanadu is going to be done.
Okay, Xanadu will be March 17th and 18th at Berks Catholic High School. The show starts at 7 o'clock, and tickets are available by going to www.berkscatholic.org. And I hope to see you there.
Yes, we all hope. Break a leg with the show.
Thank you so much.
And those of you at home, I hope you get out to see this show and support our youth in the arts. There's nothing like live theater. For Backstage, I'm your host, David Edgar Guest. We will see you next month backstage. Take care.